Thank you, Veronica. Thank you, everyone, for spending your evening with us and giving me an opportunity to relive our adventures in the Mediterranean. And this time, it will be two incredible islands. We'll start with Malta. And here the map. The map on the top, you can see the locations where Corsica is located, kind of snuggled in between two crown jewels of the world of resort of French Riviera and west shore of Italy, very close to Sardinia. And you can see Malta very close to Sicily in a map done by Alex. If he would like to do it according to actual sizes, in proportions, then Malta would almost disappear. It would be a teeny tiny dot in the middle of the Mediterranean. And the Malta archipelago is very easy to be overlooked on the map or on your bucket list to play, going to places you want to visit. Because very few Americans have Malta in their wish list. And it's a pity, because if you do visit this island, you will be forever inspired and spiritually enriched by absolutely magical beauty of that gem. And it still remains hidden for many. And what I ask you to do, please don't be fooled by Malta's size. This tiny nation of less than 500,000 of people, about 440,000 people. It packs an extraordinary amount of history, including Jewish history, into its three, you can see those, you can see just tiny pack of Malta, into its three compact islands. The largest is Malta, Woza, and Kamina. And the Jewish trajectory is absolutely fascinating, and it's still under radar for most historians. From Israelites sailing there with Phoenicians 3,000 years ago, to the first Jewish quote-unquote tourist, biblical Saint Paul, arriving in Malta in the first century CE, through the dark times of slavery during the Knights of St. John's rule in the 16th century, into today's small but blossoming community. It's just the story to behold. Malta's Jewish community today is very small. It's about 200 people, but consider the size of the island, and it's flourishing, and it's prosperous, cosmopolitan, and fully incorporated into this inclusive society of this country. And Maltese Jewish history encompasses thousands of year-old mysteries, literally etched in stone, and we will visit the stone. It also incorporates glaring contradictions that represented on one side by nations that deeply proud of its Knights of St. John's legacy, and on another by always there, always present dark memory of Jewish slavery during the Knights' rule. And I almost forgot to tell you that there are a few interesting facts for Jewish history enthusiasts. Malta has a fine kosher restaurant that's very, very popular among the visitors and the locals. Malta observes Holocaust Remembrance Day, and it was the only country to welcome Jews without visas during World War II. Last Wednesday, we talked about Shanghai, the only city that allowed Jews to come, but Malta was the only country, and that's unknown fact. And their language is Semitic. Again, it's the only one language of that kind that belongs to the 24 official languages of the European Union. And on this slide, you see the great harbor of Malta and the fortress built by the Knights. How to jump up your quest for Jewish Malta? And here I want to quote you, interesting thing. Neither Jews nor rats can exist in Malta. The Maltese are too much for either. You know who said that? British Naval Admiral Lord Fisher in the early 1900s. And he was quoted by Jewish British historian Cecil Ross, in his paper, the first paper of this kind, The Jews of Malta, that he read before the Jewish Historical Society of England, 1928. And then with a tongue in his cheek, Ross said that naval admirals' knowledge of theology, meaning rats, is much, much better than his knowledge of history, meaning the Jews. Because according to Roth, the Jewish presence in Malta goes back to time immemorial. In the best framework for understanding Maltese Jewish story and Maltese history is, well, Malta itself in all its grandeur, complexity, and contradictions. And here we are on one of the streets in the beautiful Valletta, Maltese capital. You imagine the European capital that is 0.6 miles in length and 0.4 miles in width, and all its straight streets lead to the sea. Valletta, the tiniest of European capitals, is World Heritage Site, but it's also, it's probably one of the most history saturated place in the world. You know, somebody told me, what about Jerusalem? Jerusalem is huge. Valletta is tiny, and it's incredible history packed into that. So to see Malta and to experience Malta, we will go and walk Malta of the nights and Malta nobody can imagine of the 21st century groundbreaking architecture of Renzo Piano. But you see, the first thing you notice, no matter what anybody tells you, and you just look around, it's what you see on the screen, Maltese balconies. They're everywhere in the old city, in every old building. And they're called Maltese, though they're not Maltese by nature. Maybe they were adopted after Aragonese, Kingdom of Aragon from Spain, took over in the late 1400s. Or maybe it just came to Malta much later in 1700s when two grand wooden balconies were added to Grand Master's Palace. The balcony is also called in Arabic, I can't pronounce it, it's lookout place. So they could be of North African, of Middle Eastern, or even Sephardic in origin. You see, during the Order of the knight's preferred sport was piracy. And their preferred source of revenue was ransom they collected when attacking merchant ships and taking everyone there as captive slave. So from the mid-1500s until Napoleon got rid of the order in 1798, the Jewish community of Malta consisted mostly of Jewish slaves. Almost 80% or over of the slaves in Malta were the Jewish or Turks, and among them were many talented craftsmen. So it may be them who brought this fashion. In a typical Maltese manner, there is no single answer, so go figure. And now we will try to understand Malta, walking through the nights of St. John time and to see unexpected Valletta. It's impossible not to see and experience the knights of the Order of the Knights time, because their presence felt everywhere in Valletta. You seem to breathe in Baroque grand of their churches. You humbled and overwhelmed with the power projected by their fortresses and their Maltese crosses are everywhere. And everything, this incredible Maltese universe, is surrounded by turquoise waters of Great Harbor and by the brightest sun you can imagine. By the true crown jewel of this resplendent collection of Knights of the Order creations is the St. John Co-Cathedral. It's the first time we came upon Co-Cathedral, and you see what happened. Valletta was built in 1570s after the Knights spectacular victory over the Turks. Before that, the ancient capital of Malta was Medina, and they already had cathedral there. So they built new cathedral in the 1572 and called it co-cathedral. And facade you see kind of plain, but inside it's gold, gold, and more gold, incredible sculptures and what seemed to be three-dimensional paintings. And by it was done by Calabrian artist who also was the Knight of the Order. But marble floors, you walk on beautiful art. More than 400 knights are buried in under your feet, but the Grand Masters, they have their own tombs. And you see, it's not a Jewish star, it's a Star of David. It was very fashionable to put on, but there were no Jews in the order. Only the sons of ancient aristocratic families could become members of this Knight's Order, and only if they bring a lot of money with them, especially for the second and third sons, it was very important. But for us, the main treasure of the cathedral was Caravaggio. And he created two masterpieces during his life in Malta, 1607 to 1608. And you might say, you know, what did he forget in Malta? You know, you probably seen the museums and churches in Rome and Naples with his masterpieces. We even went to Sicily to see his creations. Why Malta? What could he hope to achieve living in the middle of the sea on this tiny rock? And excuse me, who lived there? Warrior monks. The last people you would imagine would be art connoisseurs. But Caravaggio was man of the run. His life was very dramatic, just like his paintings. He killed a person in Rome during one of his night brawl. And there was a price on his head, so he was on the run. He stayed in Malta just 1 year because another drunken knight, and he seriously wounded one high-ranking knight. So he was arrested, ran away from prison, but he left behind two greatest masterpieces, Beheading of St. John the Baptist, that's considered one of the most important paintings in Western art. And Saint Jerome's writing. Now the Malta you never imagine. One of the greatest architects of our time, Renzo Piano, is there. And as his many critics used to say, Malta would be the last place in the world they could imagine for Renzo Piano to build anything, but he did. You know, his Center Georges Pompidou in Paris, or airport terminal in Osaka, or in New York, New York Times building, New Whitney Museum of American Art on the 12th Street, it's him. So he came here and he created very interesting complex, entire city complex, city gates and Piano's parliament buildings. And for us, they looked as Maltese as the balconies, as bastions, because looking at these buildings, its strangely pierced appearance, we thought about Malta's heritage as a Mediterranean fortress surrounded by nature-made cliffs and man-made bastions. Here. And it looks for me more like a library than a government building, but maybe it was intentional, we were told, to remove the hierarchies that separates people's government from the people who elected it. Well, city gates were built by Renzo Piano, and also Royal Opera rebuilt. Here on the left, you can see what's left of Royal Opera with Renzo Piano reconstructions, because he chose to leave it as it looked after heavy bombardment during World War II. And it functions only in the summer, but don't worry, Maltese would not live without their theaters. This tiny nation has four other opera and ballet theater, and one of them is the oldest opera theater in the world. Not San Carlo in Naples, but and not La Scala, but Teatro Manuel, that was built by Knights of St. John and by their grandmaster, Antonio Manuel de Villena. He wanted live theater, but he also wanted his knights to stay away from the taverns in Brussels and to have an honest entertainment to keep them from mischief. So when in Malta, When we want to travel through history in search for Jewish stories, we have to go through all layers of Maltese history. So it's naturally we'll start with prehistory, because in prehistoric structures, you will see what until recently considered one of the etched in stone evidences of the beginning of Jewish history in Malta and possibly of the entire Mediterranean. Mysterious prehistory of Malta is officially considered with the arrival of men on the islands and building of these megalithic temples. And it lasted till 800 BCE until Phoenician colonization. And this megalithic temple-like complexes, and I say temple-like because we don't know what it is, definitely not defensive structures. They're massive, impressive, they're enigmatic and strangely beautiful. And Malta and Gozo, they're dotted with these temples. This temple, the oldest freestanding structures on earth made by man. They're definitely much, much older than Stonehenge and over 1,000 years older than pyramids of Giza in Egypt. Probably it were places of worship. It's not defensive structures. And some researchers think that these temples prove that Malta was a sacred island, a place where people would assemble for their mystic rituals. And even name of Malta is considered to have come from the Phoenician refuge or from Hebrew escape. Though, believe it or not, I read somewhere that it came from ancient Greek language melitos, which means honey, in a typical Maltese fashion, go figure. Choose the origin of the name you like. So to understand more about Maltese prehistory, we had with our friend, the wonderful guide historian, Joanne Greca, go underground, literally. Hypogeum actually means underground. And it's one of its kind building in the world. It's literally underneath the earth and the best preserved prehistoric site it's complex of excavated cave chambers that includes temple, cemetery, funeral hall, and many, many beautiful art pieces that now in the Museum of Archaeology. I especially was enthralled by this teeny tiny sleeping lady from Hypogeum and made of brown clay. She has very elaborate hair, an elaborate dress, naked by waist. Down she has her interesting skirt, and it's interesting, is she eternal sleep or is she a goddess? And I really loved her, and that's how a Hypogeum looks like. It's considered that this well-preserved architecture mirrors the prehistoric architecture above the ground. And to learn more about it, we left the island of Malta, went to the island of Gozo. The capital city of Gozo called Rabat. It has a second name, Victoriosa, the city of victory, renamed by knights after their victory over the Turks, 1565. Both names are used interchangeably. And I thought, oh, was it to confuse the tourists like us? But in Malta, the past is always present. And Gozo has its own secrets. Giantia temple built by the giants, World Heritage Site. And this temple does have a very interesting art that shows that this was very sophisticated society. And nobody really knows where people come from, but the consensus historian is that they arrived from Sicily, and though they maintained contact with Sicily, this sophisticated artistically culture was created in isolation. It's homegrown, it's unique to Malta. And the temples are the same shape as this headless Earth Mother figurines that you can find anywhere in the museums and even in the ruins of the temples. And by the way, I almost forgot to tell you, no male statues were ever found. So probably it was a sophisticated artistic society where women were goddesses and guys, So kind of, it's very interesting. And Gentii is the best example of this prehistoric architecture to study, but our purpose was to find what until recently was considered in stone evidence of the ancient Jews arriving in Malta, perhaps with the Phoenicians. Did they, these ancient Jews, landed in Gaza, and did they etch their prayers using a Phoenician alphabet? What it says, if translated from ancient Hebrews in Phoenician alphabet, for the love of our father Yahweh, it were two female explorers that found this stone in the Gentian temple in 1912 and made it known. And though few authoritative studies, and the latest one was published 2013, stated that it is actual, it's at least goes back to the time of the Phoenicians, the latest position of Heritage Malta, the authoritative body, it's like our Smithsonian in history of Malta, it stated that it's most probably 19th century forgery. Forgery not, it's most probably the Jews did arrive with the Phoenicians. So we know, and it's documented, that it probably were the prosperous tribe of Asher and marine traders, tribe of Zebulun, that traveled with Phoenicians. Though, if we accept the theory that the old name of island of Gaza was Godites or Godites country, it probably was the third tribe of Gad, G-A-D, soldiers or luck, that traveled with Phoenicians and explored Mediterranean. So Phoenician period is from 800 BCE until Roman conquest. And under Phoenicians, Malta passed from prehistory to history proper or recorded history. So where did Jewish narrative fits inside this history? You see, the Phoenicians, they were Semitic people, the first recorded group to colonize Malta. They lived along the coast of what is now Lebanon and Israel. They spoke language similar to Hebrew, and they invented the first alphabet in the world. And actually, word alphabet comes from their two letters, alpha and bet. What existed before? The cuneiform script of multiple pictorian symbols. But Phoenician invention used less than 30 letters, one for each sound, was written like Hebrews from right to left. And by the first millennium BCE, the world that Phoenicians colonized used this written script, their alphabet, that later was developed into languages like Greek, like Etruscan, like Latin. And the Maltese, just like Hebrews, were one of the first beneficiaries of this gift of literacy. The ship you see on the screen, it's a well-known symbol of the tribe of Zebulun, and we will also see it repeated in ancient catacombs, places of burial. The Phoenician gifts, the language, first of all, the language, and so it's Semitic language, and if you hear Maltese speaking between themselves, it reminds you of mixture of Hebrew and Arabic, and indeed it has a lot from Arabic, but then it was Latinized by Normans, and it has influences of all major powers in history, including Roman languages from Sicily and Italians. And now the second gift, the eye, gift of the Phoenician. To see that, you have to come to the village called Marshaklok, and you would feel like you stepped into a fairy tale or the open art exhibition. You have these turquoise waters, you have the brightest sun, you have plenty of boats, many, many boats, like dancing on the water. They all have bright colors. And no matter what color is the boat, you will always see this reddish, brownish line to mark the water line. And the boats are called mustak, like mustache, because it resembles like one. And all the boats looking at you, ogling you, this Phoenician eye that protects the fishermen. Another Phoenician legacy alive and well in Malta after 3,000 years. Now let's jump into next period, Roman domination, earlier Christian period. And we have the first Jewish tourist arriving in CE 60, biblical Saint Paul. He was shipwrecked there. I'm Saul, a Jew born in Tarsus of Cilicia, and I was thoroughly trained in the law of our fathers. It's from Acts. And Saint Paul succeeded in persuading the Roman governor of Malta and most of the population to become Christians, and now he's considered spiritual father of the nation. And it's very religious, very Catholic nation. They have 365 churches in this tiny Malta, so you can go to a different church every day of the year. See, Greeks colonized and Hellenized Malta until Romans came in 2031, and Romans stayed for 600 years. See, Malta at that time, like now, it was on the crossroads that's between Europe and between Africa, and people from everywhere were coming. So it contributed to the greatest diversity of populations. So why should be the dead of Malta different? We went to the catacombs to see that Christian Jews and pagans were peacefully buried there side by side. We wanted to see that indeed there were Jews in Greek in Roman time. Malta, island of Malta consists of tiny cities, kind of like Soho, Tribeca, only much, much, much smaller. Or if you're from Cleveland, like Lyndhurst, South Euclid, and again, much, much smaller. So it's anywhere you go, it's a different city. So it's city of Rabat. That's where this largest catacombs you go to St. Paul catacombs to see. I already mentioned Rabat and Gozo, right? And there is Rabat in Malta. And I'm sure that this is done just to confuse us all. And going there, it's almost a surreal experience. We didn't see anyone. We had torchlights, just three of us, our friend Joanne Greca and Alex and I. And you see this menorahs. And also the seafaring Israelite tribe Zebulun sign. I didn't want these Jews to think that we forgot about them, so I left stones at the exit. There is a third island, Camino, teeny tiny, less than 3 square miles in size. And guess the population of Camino? 3 people after the fourth one passed away a couple of years ago. And Camino got its place of importance in Jewish history because of one Jewish sage who lived there in the 13th century. And with Camino, we enter another period in Malta, medieval period, that would include the dissolution of the Jewish community of Malta. So medieval period is considered to start with Arabs' conquest in 870. And then come the Normans from the north, you know, Normandy, north of France, Schwabian, where Bavaria is now, Angevins, royal house of France. And then Aragonese come in 1479, and the Spaniards were there to stay. So in 1492, Malta was subject to the edict of expulsion, just like Sicily, like Sardinia, like half of the Italian boot from Naples down, everything under Spanish crown. And at that time, Jewish population, Malta, very prosperous, very important for commerce and economy, was almost 30% of the population. So the governors of Malta pleaded with most Catholic monarchs, Ferdinand of Aragon and Isabel of Castile, to reconsider this edict, or at least postpone it because they feared depopulation and economic collapse. So in case with Malta, the Spaniards came up with great solution. So whose fault is that? It's the Jews. So let them pay for the loss of island's income because of their departure. So the Jews had to either convert to Christianity or leave. Those who decided to leave. They were told to leave everything behind, and Jews were very prosperous in Malta, just like in Sicily. They were allowed just old clothes, one pair of old shoes, one old mattress, and a little bit of food for the road. But those who stayed, they disappeared into Malta. They assimilated. And what was left from them? That's the names of the streets and surnames of people, like Azapardi, meaning Sephardi Jews, or Elul, months on Jewish calendar. So back to the most remarkable Jewish figure in medieval Malta, living in Kamina, remember the island with a huge population of three people? His name, this greatest Jewish figure in medieval history of Malta, was Avraham Abulafia, lived in 1240 through 1291. He was the founder of the school of prophetic Kabbalah, visionary, philosopher, far ahead of his time. He dreamed of possibility of three Abrahamic religions coming together in peace and enrichment, and even decided to go to Rome to persuade Pope of, okay, stop persecuting the Jews, support merging of these three religions together. And Pope decided that this man was total cuckoo and heretic and condemned him to be burned alive. The day of the burning, Pope died from heart attack. And it was considered the sign from heaven. So Abulafia was released. He came back to Kamina, where he died 1291. I thought it was kind of cool story. A majestic first capital of Malta. That was the city Malas colonized and built. Malta was colonized by Phoenicians, remember? So that's the city they founded, beautiful Malas. When Arabs come, they rename it Medina, and the name stick, and it served as the capital of Malta until the lights build the new capital of Valletta. And the medieval period ends with the arrival of the Knights of Trajan of Malta, who came there because they were given Malta as their headquarters by Carlos Quintus, Charles V, the emperor, holy of Holy Roman Empire, and the king of Spain. So with Medina, there was an earthquake. So a lot of medieval structures were ruined and the city was rebuilt as Baroque. But even with this Baroque architecture, Medina did not lose its very romantic character of a medieval city, and you feel like you step inside into a movie set. And it was the first season of the Game of Thrones was filmed in Medina. In Medina, we went to see Sir John Azapardi. He is the chief archivist of the Metropolitan Cathedral in Medina. Our friend Clive Costis, who is executive in Heritage Malta and historian, he understood my mindset that even without the language, just seeing ancient Jewish documents and listening to experts like Donna Zapardi, it would bring entirely different perspective on the medieval Jewish history and Jewish history of Mediterranean. And our host, Donna Zapardi, and his assistant, Mario Gauci, prepared documents related to the Jewish history of Malta. And here is Mario Gauci, a senior assistant archivist. And the oldest document is the beginning of 1300s. Most of them related to trade, to loans, trade agreements, but there are also lists of new converses, those Jews that stayed and converted to Catholicism. It was incredible experience. And here we are with Jan walking the ancient Jewish quarter, not ghetto. It was never locked from outside. It was a quarter where Jews wanted to live with their core religions and their business partners. And see the old silk market. It was a central market, was the center of life and the synagogue. And the Jews that we've seen the documents about and heard the stories, they still in Malta lying in eternal peace in the ancient Kalkara Cemetery, which is closed to visitors, but thanks to Clive, representative of Jewish community, opened it up for us. This is the oldest Jewish cemetery. It was established 1372. But then the Knights of Malta decided to re-gift it to the Jews. And who were the Jews at the time of Jews of Malta? The slaves. So we were walking through this, among the graves, leaving small stones on those. And it's the entrance. You see the sign. Translation means the cemetery was established by the Leghorn Fund for ransom. And listen to this, Hebrew slaves at its own expense for burial of the dead of the race. And a copy of this Knights of Malta authorization is in the National Library. And if you never heard of Jewish slavery, it raises the eyebrows. And indeed, Malta was the last place in Europe, the center for slave trade and for the slavery. So now we enter into the period of the Order of the Knights of Malta and the Jewish slavery, 1530 through 1798. What happened 1798? On his way from Egypt, Napoleon stops at Malta. He conquers Malta and kicks out the knights and gives the Jews for their freedom. So that period ends with Napoleon. Grand Master's Palace, Grand Masters of the Order. Look at the balcony. So some of their opinion that maybe Maltese balconies came as a fashion when this palace was unveiled in 1700s. So who were the Knights of Malta? The order was established in 1099. There were Hospitallers. The name of the order was the Order of the Hospital of St. John in Jerusalem. And the taking care of the sick and pilgrims, that was their mandate. They became famous all over Europe for their bravery in battle and their medical skills. For example, these knights were the first to recognize the importance of cleanliness, of separate cleanliness and separation of the very sick from the rest, and the usage of silver as antibacterial material, though not in these terms, but the knights did use only silver utensils in their hospital. Well, when Jerusalem was lost to the Muslims, in 1291, they withdrew to Cyprus. Less than 20 years, they were kicked out of Cyprus by the same Ottoman Turks, and they had to retreat to Rhodes, where they stayed almost 200 years. But in 1530, they lost to the Turks. And emperor comes to the rescue. He gives them Malta. And the only thing they had to do in terms of paying back is to produce one white Maltese falcon to the emperor and another white Maltese falcon to the Spanish viceroy of Sicily. So it was a low rent and came with strings attached. These warrior monks had to create in an island as a fortress. So it would be the last defense of the Christian world against the Ottoman Turks. And one of the many documents I studied on Malta, I found the quote from the 7th century Passover Haggadah in Venice. And there were a phrase translated into English, of course, we were horsemen slaves in Malta. Why? See, when knights were not the Hospitallers anymore, their only reason for existence was to wage war against the Turks, to prevent them from capturing Malta and then the keys to Europe. So what they did, they waged never-ending maritime warfare that was undistinguishable very often from piracy. The vessels they captured, they brought back to Malta, where entire crew and passengers were sold into slavery. The captives were anyone who happened to be sailing in this unlucky ship. They never targeted Jews or Jews, but when they captured the vessel, there were the large proportion of the merchant class and high number of the of the merchants were on these vessels. So there was nothing new about the piracy, capturing vessels in the sea, or slavery in Middle Ages. But what happened, because of the large proportion of Jews, Jews constitute a large proportion of slaves in Malta. So the name Malta in Jewish literature was often associated with evil. I found reference to messianic prophecy from 1600. And this prophecy predicted the fall of four ungodly kingdoms, with the first one was, guess what, Malta. So this led to a very strange phenomenon. From mid of 1500s until Napoleon came and gave freedom to Jews, abolished slavery, the only Jewish community in Malta was almost entirely of slaves. So what had to be done in Jewish world to immediately create something for the ransoming of these prisoners? And the society of dedicated to give it freedom and negotiating the ransom was created in Venice and Amsterdam, and dedicate money to that was the highest charity in the Jewish world. So, and in Malta, this society maintained a resident agent almost all the time who was to bargain and make payments to the knights. You see, the knights did not really target Jews. It just happened. There were many Jews among the slaves, and knights believed that Jews were lying. They were miserly, and they were very rich. So they bargained and bargained, and they tried to prolong negotiations as much as possible. That's why over 80% of the slaves were Jews and Turks. Free Jews who came to Malta almost exclusively for ransom negotiations had to seek permission from the Grand Master, and they could enter and leave only from this Jewish Sally port, and you see it on your screens. Jews lived in a slave prison. Right now, what you can see just a sign of it, because the building, medieval building itself, was bombed during World War II. But during the days, they were allowed to freely go out, just they were told not to mix with locals. Nobody really observed this law, to earn money, but they had to return to slave prison at night. Now we have to mention the Great Siege of Malta. Nothing is better known than the Siege of Malta, said Voltaire. It was May 1535 when Turkish fleet and army arrived to Malta with the purpose of capturing the island, and then they would have the control of Mediterranean and the key of Europe. But a spectacular victory of the knights made it impossible. So without their victory, the European history might have a very different narrative. And despite of the circulating rumors, and most of us would not be surprised, that the rumors were Jews financed the Turkish fleet. But despite that, Jews did behave very, very bravely. And the city of Burgos, that was renamed Victoria City, another Victoriosa, and it's still city of Burgos or Victoriosa, just to confuse us, commemorates participation of Jews in the siege. And we learn a lot from our friend Sarah Azapardi. Again, the name Azapardi, Sephardic Jew. She's a non-Jewish girl from Switzerland, who for some reason, she said, I probably was Jewish many centuries ago. For some reason, she chose Inquisition in Malta as a subject for her PhD. She came to Malta to do research, met a young man whom she married and became Sarah Azapardi, has two beautiful twins, the girl twins, and she's a professor at the university. She told us that her research uncovered that actually the medieval slave community was not the only Jewish community, it was the largest in the island, but there were crypto-Jews, Jews who converted to Catholicism, but as she said, people with double identity Catholics from outside, Jews inside, a tiny community of crypto Jews. And there was also conversa community, Jews that were converted and did not want to practice Judaism, was too dangerous. So the three sectors, two tiny sectors, crypto Jews and conversos, and the large group of slave Jews, they all were closely together, maintaining close ties, and they only in Malta, they were protected by the Inquisition. It's very interesting. Inquisition in Malta was established 1561, and unlike Roman Inquisition, it's never thought the capital punishment, never did the burnings. And if it's only a few Jews who were among, they arrested only for blasphemy and they had to pay the price. We went to the National Museum of Ethnography, where we learn a lot about this Roman Inquisition and tribunal, and most remarkable Jewish personality in Malta during the period of slavery. Joseph or Giuseppe Cohen, who was a slave working in the tavern where he overheard how Muslims plotted to overtake Malta and to kill the Grand Master. When he uncovered this plot, all the participants of this plot were captured, they were tried and all killed. So for his brave actions, Cohen received his freedom and huge mansion in the city and big pension. And we continue to study his story at the National Archaeological Museum with the chief curator. And this was a sign on Cohen's mansion that says that this mansion is given to Giuseppe Cohen by the Grand Master in Grand Master's name. And the small clarification of the coin's name, Neophyto, which means convert, a new Jew. He decided to convert to Christianity. So our Giuseppe was not a Jew anymore. He and everybody could see that and trust Cohen, the Jewish merchant. Now the British period, after the Napoleon was in Malta just for a couple years, the French and British came, kicked out the French. And that time is the rebirth of the Jewish community, because now the Jewish community could reconstitute itself once again as free people. And Jews were coming from Gibraltar, England, Italy, Morocco, Portugal, Tripoli, Tunis, and Turkey. And then 1846, they even hired a rabbi and brought the first modern rabbi to Malta. And during World War II was what's considered second siege of Malta, because of its position. The only allied base between Gibraltar, Spain, and Alexandria in Egypt, it served once again as a military naval stronghold. And because of its position and continuous fighting between Italian and German on one side and the British on the other side, Malta suffered the heaviest, most sustained, concentrated aerial bombardment in history. And people who were hiding in bombs, shelters, in this most heavily populated area, like in Valletta, you have 23,000 people living in less than one fourth of a square mile. These people who could not leave their shelters for days to find food or water, they opened their hearts and doors in their island to the Jews of Europe. And this is an unknown story. I never was able to find how many Jews were saved, just a mention of 1,000. Malta celebrates Holocaust, International Holocaust Remembrance Day, and now starts Holocaust education at schools. And thousands of Jews were saved in Malta, which is very, very remarkable. The most celebrated person of the new community is Ruben Ohayon, who is not a rabbi, but considered a spiritual leader, probably fourth generation of Jewish immigrants that came back about 70 years or so. His family built a synagogue the rebuilt from the first synagogue. It's actually, they bought an apartment, converted it to a beautiful tiny synagogue, but it's a small community and they have religious school. And he said, children is our future. There is Chabad and popular kosher restaurant. And only in Malta, there is a grand master, Admor of Malta, very eccentric, self-proclaimed Admor, which means scholarly leader of Jewish community, who came to Malta and Israel and established his own United Order of the Light. Now we will quickly go to Corsica, because it's another absolutely remarkable, remarkable place with an unknown history, Jewish history as well. Guy de Maupassant, renowned French writer, said that this wild island is more known, more distant to us than America, even though you can see it from the coast of France. And not much change from 1830s when Maupassant wrote it, because Corsica also remains largely unknown to tourists. Most of the tourists are French from the mainland, but it's also, you know, very few Americans go there. Corsica is called the Island of the Beauty, but by the Jews know it, it's Island of the Just. The beauty, and I want to just you to see a few slides that show Calvis, the most beautiful marine on the island. It's on the northeast shore of the island. Or we left our cart is in Bonifacio on the south. And the first tourist who loved Bonifacio was probably Homer, who described this beautiful harbor in his Odyssey. Bonifacio truly has a jaw-dropping magnificence. It's unforgettable. Corsican history is fascinating. From the megalithic period to becoming part of Papal States, when Corsica was given by Pope to Pisa in 11th century, in the 12th, it was divided between Pisa and its arch rival Genoa. Corsica became independent republic, democratic constitutional republic in 1755, when Pascal Paoli, founder of the republic, established this country. Genoa lost to the Corsicans legally, but they secretly sold the island to France. French come, they defeat Corsican army, they take the Corsica. Pascal had to immigrate to England, briefly returned with the British when they established Anglo-Corsican kingdom. You see, this succession of powers is just fascinating. And but then Napoleon comes, most beloved son of Corsicans, and he retakes his native island. And the Moor's head becomes national symbol of independence. In a curious wink of history, this Moor's head was brought in 1300 by the Aragonese rulers of Corsica, who wanted Corsica to be afraid, since they were the victorious in fighting the Moors and in Spain. That's the last untamed corner of Europe. It's Walter's Maupassant Road, still in the midst of chaos. And it's incredible, incredible beauty. And Corsicans always, always opened their heart to people who were running away from injustice and from cruelty. So their Jewish history, absolutely incredible. And to understand it, we have to understand what made Corsicans, well, Corsicans. So you can go many different ways, and here I'm asking which way we're going, Alex. What evident is this culture of independence. Corsica maintains that they have more in common with Sardinia, not only landmass, but the culture of independence. Both of these islands have this culture of proud and fierce independence, and independence movement becoming central forces within the island political spheres. And again, to understand it, it's a fascinating prehistory. We came to Filitosa, the most interesting and the most famous prehistoric site in history. And here with our friends, Masha Shelipova, she's originally from Russia, she's a manager, and Charles Antoine Cesare, who is the owner and from the families that discovered the treasure trove of prehistoric culture. Look at this, it's statue, menhirs. Menhirs is man-made up from stone, these vertical slabs, like Stonehenge. Only in Corsica, they have human faces and they follow you everywhere. So who were these people? There are no really consensus, but when Charles Cesare, grandfather invited famous architect, he determined that there were Sardinians, that most probably the first people in Corsica were Corsi, that gave its name to the island. They came from Sardinia and they brought nuragic Sardinian culture. Nuragic means these round towers you see on the top of the slide. And this in Corsica, they call Tori, so it's Torian civilization. It was our first prehistory lessons, connection with Sardinia, because Corsicans do not like French. And the feeling on mainland is mutual. Second prehistory lesson was that Corsicans were actually Sheridan warriors, ancient rebellious tribes that sold their fighting skills to pharaohs. Even Pharaoh of Ramses II said, Sheridans of rebellious mind, whom no one could ever fight against. And I'm very tempted to see the line from this very interesting people, independently mind Corsicans that we met in May 2019, back to the line of the Sheridan warriors. And some archaeologists believe that they were Sheridan who built these stories and statue menhirs. And they are this ancient ancestors of independence Corsicans. And the place to understand Corsica is Horta. And if you have just the time to visit one inland city, it should be Corta, because no other place would uncover for you an in-depth understanding of this island and mindset of its people. And Corta literally geographically is in the center of the island. And Corsican's fathers of independence, Jean-Pierre Gaffari, who was killed in 1753 in the ambush, and you can see behind his statue, his building where his family lived, all in musket bullet. These little holes, because Genoese were fighting for life and death, but they did want to give up Corta. And then after the death of Gaffari comes Pascal Paoli, who is called El Babu de Patria, the general or the father of the nation. For the Jewish history buffs, this is also where Jewish story started in Corsica. Very few historians really studied it. And this Jewish narrative of Corsica, modern narrative, starts with Pascal Paoli, who determined that Jews have the same rights as Corsicans. They share the same destiny. He was the first to proclaim Jewish freedom and Jewish political rights. The first, 27 years before United States, 28 years before France. That's an incredible person. That's the streets of medieval Corsica. And coming to Upper Town, where we visited Palais National, National Palace, where independence was proclaimed for the short-lived Republic in 1755. And symbol of the island, the citadel, where Paoli established university. Of course, the university was short-lived, just 4 years. The French came, they closed it. And you know when it was reopened, refounded? 1981, 212 years after it was closed. That's very interesting place. And as you can see, environs of view on Corte and surrounded area from the citadel. Here's a quote from Paoli, that Jews have the same rights as Corsican, but Jewish presence in Corsica goes back almost a millennia. And they broke it into chapters. First 800 years, in the year 800, the group arrived from Egypt. They came to Porto Vecchio and then immediately settled in mountain villages who locals named Levi. We don't know who were the people, these people who were, who they were running away from, but what we do know is that they spoke and wrote Hebrew, and there are documents written in Hebrew in some ancient village churches in the region. Chapter 2 comes in 1500s when over 1,000 families run away from Naples, south of Italy. Why? Remember, Edict of Expulsion, 1492. They again go to hard to get to mountainous villages. Then 1684, pogroms in Padua, which was part of Venetian Republic, and they're called Padovani by the locals. Chapters 1 and chapter 2, as I call the spirits in Jewish narrative, had the same outcomes. The Jews disappeared into Corsica, intermarried, assimilated. But the names like Padovani, Jacobi, Gabrieli survived. Then chapter 3, modern narrative. Paoli asked Jews to come from Livorno, west coast of Tuscany, from Spain and Catalonia. He wanted the Jews to settle among the Corsicans and with all naturalization rights, voting rights, or privileges. Why? He needed to build firm economic foundation. After 500 years of Genoese, he wanted the Jews to become the merchant and to have rights to sell corals, to hunt for corals. He established El Rus village, which is now a popular resort. And the same outcome, they melted into Corsica. And then we meet Napoleon, who wanted to free the Jews to make them full citizens. And for the Jews, Napoleon is the greatest hero. He is a leader whose civic code of 1804 proclaimed full freedom to the Jews, and who, as it's, you know, some writers like to use the word, brought down the walls of ghetto. Anywhere he went to, he would proclaim freedom to the Jews. Napoleon was a favorite son of Ajaccio. That's where he was born, 1769. And this is the house where he was born. You meet Napoleon everywhere. And that he is the reason we came to Ajaccio, but it's also the capital of the island and where contemporary Jewish story begins. Here you see Napoleon dressed like Roman emperor and his brothers like Roman senators around them, Bonaparte story, plus the Austerlitz. See Napoleon on the top and his two-corner hat, just like in Les Invalides in Paris, the same similar statue. And the last place that you absolutely cannot leave Ajaccio without it, it's a Cardinal Joseph Hesch, who was one of the greatest art collectors in Europe. That's his palace and museum. When Cardinal went to Rome in 1803 to become a cardinal, he brought 16,000 pieces of incredible art, mostly Italian, that now in Vatican museums and in museums around the world, like Metropolitan. And he was Napoleon's uncle, just 6 years older. They were good friends. He supported his ambitious nephews, but then they stopped talking. Their relations soured, you know, because of who? The Jews. Do you know, said the cardinal to his nephew, the Holy Scriptures predict the end of the world when the Jews are recognized as belonging to a Christian nation as equals? And the cardinal even refused to come to Napoleon's coronation when he became an emperor. The Jews in Corsica in the 20th century, it's Ajaccio. That's where French ships landed and brought 800 Jewish families from French-mandated territories of Syria and Lebanon during World War I. And then were Jews from Morocco. They wanted to come to France. They thought they were French citizens. French allowed them, but not to France proper. They sent them to what was widely considered the island of misery and poverty. But Corsica always was a part of other European countries, and they open up again their hearts in their purses to make new arrivals comfortable. And Prefect of Corsica and Mayor of Ajaccio did a lot in organizing accommodations for newcomers, but then they moved new refugees, they moved to Bastia, there already was very small Jewish community. And in Bastia, it's the only synagogue, if we don't count Chabad, that still exists, even though community is consist of just few old people. What is not known that due to their generous heart and minds and to the mystery of Omerta or the vow of silence for Corsican mafia, so many Corsicans risk their lives to save thousands of refugees, mostly from Europe, mostly from Southwest France. See, Omerta implies the categorical prohibition of cooperating with the state authorities. Never, ever, under any circumstances, you have to cooperate with authorities. So when Vichy authorities came to find out if there are Jews in Corsica, they were told no, there is none. And Corsican used multiple tricks to keep the Jews concealed. They issued false identity paper, false ration cards. And somebody became suspicious. They knew that somebody has suspicion about this new arrivals. They transferred them to different villages. And nobody knows the story until 2010, when documentary was made, when the filmmakers took their viewers, the French documentary, very difficult to find. They took their viewers from one village to another where descendants of those who hid the Jews would be talking to, what's the big deal? We always did that. One said, my grandmother was not hiding a Hebrew. You know, there are no word Jew in Corsican language. She was hiding a persecuted persons. And the 21st century's Jewish revival in Corsica brought by, mostly by Chabad. In a recent article in Corse Main on anti-Semitic violence in France that pushing growing number of French Jews to immigrate, op-ed written by editor-in-chief said, Jewish France, are you living in Ile-de-France? Come to us, come to island of Corsica. Everyone will leave you alone. And now with Chabad in Ajaccio and in Bastia and in Porto Vecchio, Ajaccio is the headquarters. Hundreds and hundreds of people come to Jewish holidays. So it's very big deal. And so it's a revival of Jewish life and a Muslim community participate. You see behind Chabad rabbi, young man, very clever, very brilliant young man, Levi Princeton. You see mayor of Ajaccio, he's without hat. And the other man in hat, it's chief imam of Ajaccio. I don't know his name, but it's a celebration that attracts many, many people. So what lessons can we come away with from Malta and Corsica? First, that the Jewish history there, though unknown for many, goes back to times immemorial in Malta to at least a millennium in Corsica. And both countries were safe haven for Jewish refugees during the Holocaust. Malta is the only country in the world that did not require visa during World War II. And Corsicans love to say that they're the only place in the world where never ever had any anti-Semitism. It's the only region in the world where Jews were never persecuted by all this embraced. Corsicans are not as observant religiously as other Catholic countries, like take Malta or Italy, and they would never differentiate between themselves or people who just arrived. So if you need to be hidden, you will be hidden. And Jewish Corsican Jewish memory is part of the Corsican soul, we were told. So throughout the centuries, Corsican had always been open to those who needed refuge from injustice. And today, Judaism is alive and well in both Malta and Corsica. And thank you very much. Thank you for staying with me even longer. It's a big story. And if you want to read more tales about diaspora identity, Jewish history, little known or unknown Jewish communities, it's in my latest book, and it's available in the New City Library and in many libraries around the country. It's also available in Amazon in paperback and ebook. It's on Kindle. So thank you. I've always relive our life in these two islands.